The best place for sunrise. Just open up your door to breathe in the sunshine. Sing with us on the porch.
Today is October 31st, 2015. Joining us on the porch are Cam Caruso, Adam Schmidtmann, and Ben Borenstein.
The best place for family. What are you waiting for? Where friendships run deeper. Come join us on the porch. So glad you're on the porch.
That's right, kids. You made it another week. And your audio saviors are here once again. It's On the Porch Radio Hour. Something was brought to my attention recently that I don't get a really awesome introduction like other big name talk show hosts. I don't have a curtain to walk out of. You know, I don't have a big crowd listening to me. But I think it's fair for you to, you know, have me introduced to you. I think that's only fair. The reason it was brought up to my attention, though, is because I don't ever tell anybody who I am either. So nobody ever knows who this voice is. And when I heard those words come out of somebody's mouth, I was a little offended. And there were two gentlemen standing behind me, and I think they were also offended because they then stood right in front of me. They both just stepped out and stepped right back in front of me. And after they had exchange some words with the person that was saying that they didn't recognize my voice or that nobody would know my voice, and they I thought it was very respectful and courteous the way that they explained to that person, but then they turned around and they introduced themselves to me, and it was Adam Schmidtmann and Cam Caruso, and they were there, and for the rest of that evening we were at a really schmancy cocktail party event thing. And they kind of acted as my bodyguards, and so everywhere that I walked in my suit, which you'll see in the pictures during this show, I had on this same suit and my really fantastic hat, and I looked very classy. I was carrying an umbrella, and I had two bodyguards, and it was very nice. So there we are at this cocktail party, and I'm walking around, and as I went to get more of those little hot dogs wrapped in the dough, I don't know what that's called, but like pigs in a blanket or something. Thanks, we have an audience member that knows what those are called. I think that's the person that made them at the cocktail party. Thanks, by the way, the sauce was delicious. So we had these toothpicks, and we were dipping the hot dogs in a pigs in a blanket things into the sauce, and they were delicious. And as I was going in to the sauce, another toothpick with like kielbasa or something on the end of it came flying in and knocked my sausage out of the way, my hot dog pig in a blanket thing out of the way. And my bodyguard stepped right in, and there's Ben Borenstein standing there with kielbasa on the end of his toothpick and sauce. And there I am with my pig in a blanket and no sauce. And I was like, get him, boys. And then they were like, no, wait, we know this guy. We know this guy. He's cool. He's cool. It was a total misunderstanding. And Ben was like, yeah, it was a total misunderstanding. So there we were, the four of us. And we then devoured all of the meat wrapped in various things. Meats wrapped in meat. That was a good one. There was like seafood wrapped in farm food, and it was delicious. And we, there wasn't any sauce left. There was only a couple toothpicks left. And the four of us stood at the table, and every time somebody walked over, my three bodyguards would turn and just sneer, and everybody would walk away. So we ate all of the hors d'oeuvres and drank some pop, and we hung out. And then we started talking about how we all have the same love, which is what brings us all here to the radio show, and that love was pigs. Everybody loves pigs, not just the taste of the pig, but those little ones that fit inside your coffee mug. They're wicked cute. And so now I have pictures of pigs that fit in various mugs and cups and saucers and bowls on my phone, and I just kind of scroll through them when I'm having a bad day. And the one picture of the one that has the little floaty and it's swimming across the kiddie pool, yeah, it looks like a cow. It's like spotted like a cow. It's my favorite. So I'm gonna have a pig someday, you'll see me at a cocktail party in my suit and hat with my umbrella and a tiny little pig tucked under my arm in a coffee mug, and my three bodyguards, and we'll work our way over to the meats wrapped in meats table, and you can find us there. But until that event happens again, which I think will probably be happening soon, and since it's Halloween, I'm supposed to throw in a quick shout out for Halloween. What's up? So thanks, Halloween, for being here. And I just wanted to do that, my buddy Halloween. And so the thing is that me and my bodyguards won't be trick or treating this year because nobody's caught on to the kids can knock on my door and I can drop meat wrapped in meat in their bag. Like the parents aren't into that. Apparently they're worried about this sharp toothpick thing because when I was a kid, you know, it was like razor blades and apples. But then we've progressed to toothpicks and meat, and that's people aren't going for that. So, you know, when I get my bag full of treats x-rayed at the emergency room and they're like, sir, you've got meat wrapped in meat with a toothpick, I'm gonna have to take that. It's unsafe. I get really sad. And then my bodyguards beat up the emergency room guy and we go trick-or-treating some more. You know, but again, until that happens, we're gonna have a great show. I want to welcome everybody, and we'll talk more later. For now, Cam Caruso, you're on the porch.
Loving the things we wish we had, show off and make others feel bad. Loving the untouched desire that casts this world into a fire, and hating others for who they love. Support is not what we speak of, and hating the ones we love most because of the grudge we hold close. We take and give back nothing, yet we fear what we have coming. There's always a chill, cause our hearts are cold, but you can't turn from the flames like blood in the snow. Destroying countries to show who's inferior, and others to show which God's superior. Destroying the air with our cars, we can undo all of these scars. Creating reason behind the walls and the unknown can cause the king to be overthrown, causing fear in the minds of the bliss, cause our trust to dismiss. We take and give back nothing, yet we fear what we have come. There's always a chill because our hearts are cold, but you can't turn from the flames like the blood in the snow. We take and give back nothing, yet we feel what we have come. There's always a chill because our hearts are cold, but you can't turn from the flames like blood in the snow.
Thank you.
Tonight's episode of On the Porch Radio Hour is brought to you by Utility Poles. Utility poles, whether buried in the ground, reaching for the clouds, or laid horizontally for recreational purposes, are used for many applications. Used in parking lots, on obstacle courses, in construction of towers, and many, many other things, it's no wonder that they are called utility poles. First used by Samuel Morse, the utility pole was quickly found to be the preferred apparatus connecting thousands and thousands of miles of power lines. Mr. Morse needed line to connect his offices between Baltimore and Washington, D.C. He originally decided to bury his line underground, but quickly experienced too many issues. That's when utility poles moved in. The first order was placed in 1844 by Mr. Morse for 700 sound chestnut posts, no less in diameter than 8 inches at the bottom, tapering to 5 or 6 inches at the top. Some of those posts were still in use 80 years later. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, 80 years later. Thank you, utility poles. Ever since then, utility poles have been the number one choice for intelligent people the world around. Every time you need a 35-foot pole, you should think one thing. Utility poles. Treated or untreated, these massive posts will wow your friends, concern your neighbors, and entertain your kids for hours at a time. One satisfied customer is quoted as saying, "Wow, that's nice." That says it all. Utility poles, found wherever large items are sold. Just over 1 year ago, Ben Borenstein and Adam Schmidtmann met. And so it wasn't too long after that that we all found ourselves at a cocktail party. But
it was a good party.
It was a great party. It was a great party. So I'm just going to stop there because I said your names. You've been introduced. Let's just cut to the chase, right? Because I was going to come up with this really creative, and I'm done.
Oh, all right.
Well, I'm done being creative. Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. So Ben and Adam, you met just over a year ago. Is that right?
I think a year and a half.
I think October-ish. Yeah. Well, we had the rehearsals first. We did the last 5 years.
Okay.
Before our commercial break, you were talking about how you weren't quite arguing, but there was a debate happening about where you were and how it happened, and we thought it was October and you were doing a thing, and then I heard something about 5 years and I don't have any idea because you just met a year ago. So
Adam was performing. I saw Adam perform in Your Good Man Charlie Brown.
Oh, that's right.
Which was that with Fulton
that
Community
was
Theater?
CMA Arts Center.
Oh, okay. But it was a different location.
Correct. They were at the old place that
yes.
we're at.
Yes.
Yeah, the church.
Yes. And before then, I'd been reached out to from Marguerite Beebe and mm-hmm. Marlena Beebe through Encore Presentations, and they wanted to do the last 5 years, and they asked me to be the music director, and they said we want Adam to be... There's only two leads in the show, so they said they wanted Adam mm-hmm. to be the male lead, and so I went and saw him in You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown, and I met him after the show because I went up to him and I said, "Hey, this is what's going on. This is the musical that we want to do, and we want you to be Jamie." And
I immediately said yes.
Well, sure.
I don't think he even finished the question.
We were best friends since then.
You would have to be.
Super tight.
And here we are. We're doing another show. He's over me now. He's the boss.
Which is really scary to be your boss because I know you first as you're the one in charge. And then if I do something wrong, then you're like, "Oh, you got to fix that." And now I'm like, you got to fix that.
It's hard. I'm not going to lie. The shoes are definitely on the other foot now because I'm scared. Now I'm scared of, I'm kidding. No,
it's
awesome. We have, as performer and music director and director and music director, we have a good team.
Yeah, I think so.
We like it.
Yep. It's been fun to watch.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad.
Yeah, it is.
Fun.
It is.
It doesn't always seem fun on this end. So I'm glad it looks entertaining.
Right.
On that end, so
that's good. Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
Well, I don't know if it's entertaining.
It's all stress
but it's fun.
And tears over here.
Yeah,
but at least we put on a good facade.
Yes.
Right.
So Adam, you're the director of Oliver.
Yes.
And Ben, you're the music director.
Trying to be.
Right. Yep. It's going all right. It's going all right.
Yes.
I'm singing now, so that's good.
That's right.
Yeah, I always have to. I want to be clear that I talk about myself a lot during your interview.
That's good.
Okay. I didn't notice.
I prefer that, honestly, because it takes the awkwardness off me. So
right. Right.
It's all good.
That's why I do it, actually.
When you get complimented sometimes, I'm like, don't look at me. We'll just kind of hang out.
Yeah. Okay. Let me back up. So, Adam, you're the director. Ben, you're the music director. Mm-hmm. And as the director and the music director, you're working closely together. And what I'm understanding is that, Ben, you're taking... I'm using the word direct and director and direction a lot, but you're taking direction from Adam.
Yes.
And you also have creative license and a vision for how the music you want the music to happen.
Yes. Yep. Right? Mostly it's a collaboration. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I would say if he feels strongly about something, we'll go with his way. If he knows I feel strongly about a musical choice, then we talk about everything. There's never any
Give you a vision of how I want the song to feel.
Yes.
And then he just takes it away and he said, okay, Adam wants this, so we're going to do it this way.
Right.
And he's done a super job of explaining that to the actors and singers and really making it exactly what it needs to be.
Right.
And it seems without effort.
Yeah. I have an awesome director.
It's true.
Gives me a clear cut idea of what he wants, and that's what we got to go with.
Right. Yeah. So from personal experience, I'm in a position where this is my first musical, and I've felt a couple of times where the person that I'm acting with in a scene, we're like, you know what? We think it should go this way. Mm-hmm. And so then we do that. And so now, as I'm hearing you explain this, it's really becoming clear to me. I don't know why I didn't before, but it's really becoming clear to me that so we're putting our thoughts into it, and then Ben is putting his thoughts into it, and Adam, you're having your own thoughts, but so you're then watching all of our thoughts happening, and it's quite it becomes really complicated really fast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it's not even, I guess, maybe not complicated. It's a nice collaboration. There are some directors who it needs to be this way,
only this way, this,
and there's no other way that they want to have it seen. Mm-hmm. And some directors are just go up there and do whatever you want. Mm-hmm. And I was hoping that being my first time as a director, I can try to find exactly what kind of a director I am. Mm-hmm. And I really would like both. I try to give guidelines as to what I want to see, but the actors that we've cast are so creative and so intuitive on stage that I basically say, this is kind of what I want to see, and just show me what you got. Mm-hmm. And great stuff happens.
Yep. Yeah, I think specifically so. You're definitely someone that went with that. Mm-hmm. You know, you went with your awesome idea, and it worked. It really worked with how everybody, you know, how I saw the song and how Adam saw the acting. Yeah. And it all
and
came together.
And I shouldn't
really
be saying this, but it's one of my favorite scenes in the whole show.
Oh yeah.
Are the two scenes that you're in with
Stephanie. Yes.
And Katie, Chris.
Yep.
Yeah.
Ruby.
Yeah.
Yep.
I'm a little biased, but I think it's great.
It should be. No, you really should be. It's really good.
It's really cool. Okay, so you're putting all of that together, and that's just one scene.
Right.
So at the end of that, how much time then outside of rehearsal are you going through your notes and communicating with all of the other people that are in your direction team, because there are things that are and need to be like constantly getting fine-tuned, and you're having to communicate that. So how, like, you're spending a lot of time, putting all that together.
Yeah, I mean, sleep is a foreign subject to me now, which is fine.
Yep.
I mean,
insomnia as usual.
Yep,
it's very regular.
It's great. It fuels me, and the way notes kind of work, I guess, is it's kind of when it happens, especially towards the end of the rehearsal side of it, is I'll be taking notes throughout the entire production. And if I have any notes for Ben as the musical director or Amy Price as the choreographer, I'll go to them after I give the notes to the actors. And that's kind of how we do our notes towards the end. Mm-hmm. In the beginning, we have production meetings, and it's more of talking about the vision. Each one has a vision, and we'll have separate meetings. I've had a meeting with just Amy and myself. I've had a meeting with just Ben and myself, and basically just going through what I want both of them to kind of
piece
do.
By piece.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then it kind of all comes together
right
in a nice little thing.
Yeah.
There are, of course, the midnight texts. Hey, I don't know if you're up, but what are we going to do about such and such?
Right. Right.
Those are the best.
That happens a lot.
Because you're like just dozing and then you hear your phone go off. You're like, I turn to Taylor, I say, oh, babe, there's a problem with the show. Yeah. We got to figure this out.
Or I get an idea. Sometimes I'll sleep and I'll have a dream and I'll wake up and I'll say, Amy, we need to do
this. We
got to
figure it out.
Ben, this is how the song should be now. Yeah. And I'm glad that I can dream about it because it's not like I spend enough time thinking about it.
Right,
so.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. I have to think about it in my
24 hours a day is not enough.
No,
surprisingly.
Really I agree. That happens with me too.
Yeah.
You mentioned that this is your first time directing.
I did.
How are you feeling?
I don't know. I mean, I feel like it's going well.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I love what I see on stage. Mm-hmm. So
it is for me, it's no different than working with any other director. He knows what he's doing. He's very organized.
Right.
He has a vision, and everything that he's delivered has been really professional. So for me, it's been a great experience. I don't see you as a beginner.
Wow.
Thank you. Yeah. He has already advanced into the director world, so
yeah,
wow,
it's been really good.
Thanks.
I'm proud of you.
Thank you.
I'm very proud of you.
I was not expecting that. Thank you. That really means a lot because I get so nervous. Like, oh, I hope this is going really well, mm-hmm. and I hope they're having a good time. I want them to have fun. And then
you're on your A game all the time.
People come up to me
really?
And say, "This is really great."
Yeah,
and I love it, and I'm so glad that I can do that for them.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, and you've had the opportunity as a director mm-hmm. to respond to a lot of unique things, at least in my experience. This is my first musical, so I don't have a ton. I don't have any theater experience. So I feel like you're responding to some unique things that I would think, you know, as a camp director, mm-hmm. I'd be like, yeah, of course. You know, of course that happened. Those things happen all the time. But this is theater. And
right.
So I'm like, geez, does stuff like that happen all the time? So anyway, I think that's really cool, and to back up what Ben is saying, mm-hmm. it makes a lot of sense, because I wouldn't, if I didn't know, then I wouldn't know that it was your first your first time, because I feel like you're responding very professionally. Mm-hmm. You obviously know what you're doing, and you've been in theater for a long time, so that makes sense.
Yeah, I think it really helps that I'm first and foremost an actor and singer myself.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that really helps because I can relate to my cast.
That's
and
right.
I know how it feels to be on that end.
Mm-hmm.
So I can explain to them in a way that some directors who don't have a lot of stage experience, I can relate to them in a different kind of a way. And I think
right.
that really helps mm-hmm. the cast. And it's a little bit more of a friendship mm-hmm. that happens. So, and I think that helps.
Yes.
And I have great mentors mm-hmm. with me as well. I have Nancy Fox, who's mm-hmm. the executive producer, of the Art Center and the producer of Oliver.
Mm-hmm.
And she's on my left side, and I have Amy Price on my right side. And they've both been in theater for years, and they've directed a very long time, and they really know the ins and outs of theater.
Mm-hmm.
So I have them right by my side. If I ever have any questions, they're right there to answer them for me. And I mean, they'll even pull me aside during a scene, and they'll say, hey, I get what you were doing with this, but have you thought about doing it this way? Do you want to try it that way? Maybe it'll be a little bit different, because as for a director, for me, I see it this way, and I will absolutely try it because, I mean, like I said, they know what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So I will absolutely try anything they say. And then sometimes it works out and I end up changing a little bit to what they saw. And sometimes I kind of stick to my guns and I say, you know what? Thank you for the idea and I really like it, but I see it a little bit more this way.
Mm-hmm.
And they're so gracious about that.
Yeah.
Letting go of letting me have that freedom to cool. pick and choose.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah. Well, you know, it's a very experienced team. There's a lot of excellent energy that's happening there. I think it's going really well. So I'm excited for next Thursday, which we'll talk about soon.
We sure will.
But I have a question for Ben real quick, because this is not your first time mm-hmm. Musically directing a show. So give us a quick musical direction background.
I started music directing at a church that I went to, University United Methodist Church, and I did a few shows there, and then I helped a friend locally. I helped him assistant music direct a few musicals, and then I signed on with Encore Presentations
mm-hmm.
For the last 5 years, and did that show with them last year, and we just finished Songs for New World. And I have signed up for future projects. We have a Christmas cabaret coming up, and then we have auditions for two musicals in the spring. So we have a lot of plans. But this is Oliver is my first time with the CNY Arts Center and Fulton Community Theater. So
cool.
Cool. I liked it. I love it so far.
Awesome.
I love the center.
Good.
Everybody's awesome.
Yeah, I think it's been a really good connection. Mm-hmm. It's been a lot of fun to watch you working too. It's really neat to I think my favorite part of the whole show is the musical warm up.
Do I laugh? My musical warm ups. Oh gosh, that's actually really funny because every time we go into warm ups, I'm always like, oh, I'm nervous because I don't have any warm ups planned.
Yeah.
I want to go up and then I want to go down and then I'll go up again and down. But so I'll like write on my pad next to me and I'll write down, oh, when we go up, let's do this. And then we go. I usually end up scratching it all and say, oh, let's just do this. Okay, mm-hmm. Let's do this. It's so funny. I can see the kids are always like, we did this one yesterday. Okay, well, I didn't think about any new ones. So
yeah, it works just warm up. They sound great. So
right.
Whatever system you got going on,
that's
you
right.
Keep
after
that.
A certain point, I usually say to my director, let's have them warm up before they come in. Why is that? Because I don't want to do it.
Yeah, I'm tired of this. Give me something new. And and before we get to the information, mm-hmm. I always like to try to make a personal connection with our audience. So Ben, I'd like you to give us a 30 second bit about poo.
Poo?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my gosh. Ani is Ani poo poo is what we call her. She'll be three on Christmas. I got her a few years ago from something actually traumatic that was happening in my life, and I really wanted a dog. So I got a puppy, and she's literally my life and my joy. She is my child. I love her with all my heart, and my friend named her Poo Poo, so that's how the name Poo Poo stuck. My mom says, why do you call her that? But it just stuck, and now everybody knows her as Poo Poo, so... but she's a Shih Tzu. She'll be three on Christmas, and she's everything. She's my whole world. I love her.
Yeah,
I can't wait to see her.
Yeah, it was in your notes that you love your dog.
I'm obsessed with her.
Yeah,
I'm obsessed.
That was the word. That was the
Taylor
word.
Taylor will agree. Yeah. She's always says, "You give that dog more attention than me." I do, unfortunately. I love her.
I see awesome. So many videos on Facebook and Snapchat.
Look at Poo Poo playing with her toys. Like, what dog doesn't play with toys? But she just does it so much cuter than any other dog. So I have to share it with the world.
That is awesome. We should have a
rehearsals.
Dog show.
Yeah. She usually, actually, I usually bring her to rehearsals with me. I brought her to Songs for a New World almost every rehearsal. But funny. Unfortunately, Nancy said no dogs allowed in the center, so I can't bring her to Oliver. Because I always talk about how her and Lily playing would be the cutest.
Yeah.
Like, so cute.
Yeah, that would be awesome. Thanks. Because I had to hear about Pooh. I didn't hear enough about her during the
show. She's all black, a rare breed. I love her.
A rare breed. Of course he plays with her more. She's a rare breed. Cut him some slack. So give us the nitty gritty on Oliver. Give us the deets.
Details. The show is called Oliver, and it opens November 6th, 7th, and 8th, which is a Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And then also the following weekend, which is the 13th, 14th, and 15th, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. The Friday and Saturday shows are at 7 p.m. And the Sunday shows are
at 3 p.m.
3 p.m. They're at 3.
Yep.
It's our unanimous. Calls at 2. Never mind. Yes. Don't hear me.
And tickets are $12 for adults and $10 for
students.
For seniors. And students.
And students, yeah.
And 5 to 9 is
pay their age. Mm-hmm.
What a
and
good
zero
deal.
To four is free.
Boom.
For tickets.
That's like, remember Ground Round, the restaurant? You paid your weight that when you were a kid under the age of
that's right.
11, you'd pay, like, if you weighed 70 pounds, you'd pay 70 mm-hmm. cents to eat.
So this is cool. Just with age.
Very
same
cool.
Thing.
Yeah.
Go CNY Art Center.
They know what's going on.
Yeah, we're going to have a scale back. Right at the front door.
Yep.
Everybody can
bring it back.
If you're taller than Oliver, you have to pay. If you're shorter than Oliver, you don't have to pay. It's like a ride at the carnival.
Where's Ruby? Let's check that.
Good luck, kids. Yeah, this is the. We'll have a red line on a piece of paper with stapled or taped to the door.
This height.
Yeah. This is the Oliver pass. If you're lower than that.
And it's at the CNY Arts Center. in Fulton in the old Kmart Plaza, which mm-hmm. is right off from 481 to the right. Yes. As soon as you get off 481, you turn right at the light, and it's in that big plaza where the Kiga Community College mm-hmm. is located.
Yeah,
we're in between that and the old Kmart.
Thanks so much for being on the show.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, man.
This is the coolest thing ever.
We're going to have you guys back on the porch just because it was fun.
What? Okay.
All right. We'll have another.
Can we prepare like a rap thing for Oliver? Or?
Yeah. Ooh,
yeah.
We really could make it happen.
Yeah.
So tomorrow?
Yeah.
Tomorrow? Another radio show? Tomorrow?
Yeah. Let's do it.
Okay.
Well, yeah. I'm not doing anything, I don't think.
Awesome.
I'll have wine. It's probably the show. So maybe the week after.
Did you just say you're going to have wine?
Yeah. Yeah, we have wine on the show. Sometimes, on my birthday, we did a wine tasting show while drinking wine.
Where is it now?
Or no, because you're drinking wine.
Yes, yes, and yes. Both. We should have a show, and lots of corrugated beverage. We'll just have boxes and boxes of wine. It's my favorite.
Deal. Nice
bladder.
I'm ready.
Bladder of wine. Oh my God, we're okay. Wow, you're getting torn out here. Well, we'll see you around, Ben. Thanks for being on the show.
Love you.
Catch you on the flip. See you at the show tomorrow. We'd like to check in with our traveling investigative reporter, Mobile Holmes, who, in honor of the holiday, is in Sleepy Hollow, New York, checking out the festivities. Mobile, how are things in Halloween country?
Hello, Matthew and On the Porch listeners. I am in Sleepy Hollow, New York, and having a grand time. They have a display of over 7,000 jack-o'-lanterns and food and tours and costumes and...
Whoa. Slow down, Mobile. Sounds like you're having a good time. Can you tell us a little about the history and connection of Sleepy Hollow to the Halloween holiday?
Well, I know there was a story about a horseman that rode around looking for his head and took other people's heads but wasn't ever really satisfied. Then there was a character named Ichabod, I think.
Oh. You see, I was hoping you had put your investigative skills learning about that. Since you've been there for almost a month.
Right. The celebration here in Sleepy Hollow lasts a whole month, and I decided to be here to try to get a feel for it and the townspeople's interactions and support of the festival.
Oh. Okay, well, what did you find?
Well, Matthew, it has rich traditions dating back to an earlier time when stories were told and pumpkins were carved and kids are encouraged to dress up in costume and walk door to door of the town's homes, where they are given treats from the residents. A great time is had by all in this unusual practice. It's very unique to Sleepy Hollow and its residents.
Nope. No, it isn't unique to Sleepy Hollow at all.
Oh, really?
Yeah, really. Investigate that. What other surprises do you have for us, Mobile?
Well, I'm here with a local celebrity. I'd like to hear from him what it's like to live and work in this Halloween crazy town. Garrett Gordshoulder has been running a haunted house attraction for the last 10 years and has worked in it every night. Garrett, what brought you to start the haunted house?
I need a new head. Why not open an attraction that would lure people in so I have a constant supply of options? And they pay to get in.
That is so interesting. I bet you meet all kinds of interesting people.
I do, but none with a good head on their shoulders. That's why I've been in business here for 10 years.
What do you plan to do once you've found the perfect head?
I'm going to take it and put it on myself and ride off into the sunset. There, I plan to live out the remainder of my days thinking and combing my hair. This pumpkin is an okay replacement, but I'm sick of the amount of money I spend on candles.
It is a lovely pumpkin.
See me in another week when it started to rot and sink in.
Good point. The community members must love the act, though. It seems like you would get a great response.
It's not an act. I actually have to grow and store and carve my own head. I'm always replacing it. Why, one particularly long night at the haunted house, I sat down on the front steps and fell asleep. I woke up covered in toilet paper and shaving cream with my head smashed all over the sidewalk. It is not nice.
Oh my goodness. Had that happened before?
Oh yes. That was no isolated incident, my friend. Do you know how many times I've had to figure out how to pull myself off of pole and wooden stakes after I've been dragged out into the middle of a cornfield or garden to keep away the birds?
Your costume is very convincing.
Listen, lady. This is my outfit. All of the time. It's how I dress.
Well, you have to live the part, right?
I'm not living a part. I'm trying to live my life. This is the biggest problem. Nobody believes me.
Do you think I could get a couple of comp tickets for your haunted house? I need to get a good story for the worker. I'm fired.
Yeah, that's fine. Do you know any good-looking male friends with a strong jaw and nice, thick hair?
Why is that?
Just curious.
Mobile, we're still on the air, and you may want to find that story in another town. Maybe you can bring us the history of Turkey at Thanksgiving next month.
Sure, I guess. I want to thank Garrett for the interview. He's riding a horse around waving a flaming pumpkin in the air. He's really taking his job seriously.
Okay. Well, that was Mobile Holmes from Sleepy Hollow, New York. Thanks, Mobile. Safe travels. Mobile? I guess she's gotten right off into her next report. I hope. That was our traveling investigative reporter, Mobile Holmes, from Sleepy Hollow, New York, and a very interesting interview, I must say. Thanks, Mobile, wherever you are. You're listening to On the Porch Radio Hour. We'll be back in a moment.
This is what's happening in Central New York. U.S. Oswego offers a free breakfast for veterans on November 11th and a USO-style dinner and show on November 13th at the American Foundry in Oswego. For more information, visit usoswego.com. Little Shop of Horrors closes tonight at the CNY Playhouse. Visit cnyplayhouse.com for more information. SUNY Oswego's Track and Field program hosts a Halloween Haunted Mile run tomorrow, with a costume run for children 12 and under. Registration begins at 9:30 a.m. in the Laker Hall lobby. For more information, call 315-312-4149. Oliver opens at the CNY Arts Center in Fulton on November 6th and runs for 2 weekends. Tickets are on sale now. The CNY Arts Center is also currently offering classes for adults in painting and in cake decorating. And through tomorrow is hosting Hallows Eve, an art exhibit celebrating the spirit of Halloween. For more information, other projects and events at the Arts Center, or to purchase tickets to Oliver, please visit cnyartcenter.com. The Oswego Music Hall presents The Hook with Cam Caruso, John Cadley, and Catalina on November 13th at 7:30. The Music Hall also offers an open mic hosted by Scott Regan on Friday, November 6th, and presents Driftwood on Saturday, November 7th at 7:30 p.m. Visit oswegomusichall.org for more information. Oswego Porch Fest hosts a benefit concert on November 21st at 7 p.m. at the American Foundry. The event will feature music from The Shambles and Rhonda Helene. Proceeds will support Porch Fest 2016. Call 315-529-3926 or visit oswegoporchfest.com for more information. The Oswego Players presents The Best Christmas Pageant Ever, directed by Jennifer Snow. The show opens December 11th and runs for 2 weekends. Visit oswegoplayers.org for more information. The Red Room Sessions at the Wooden Apple Farmstead are a time for songwriters, musicians, and anyone else who wants to build their musical skill and knowledge to get together. We share songs we are working on, bounce musical ideas off each other, and we usually have time to just play a little music. This is a supportive environment where all levels of songwriting and musical experience are welcome. The next session is November 29th at 6 p.m. For more information, visit Wooden Apple Farmstead on Facebook or call 315-591-0711.
CamCarusoMusic.com is where you need to find our next guest because he's that good. And unless you're showing up at the Oswego Music Hall open mic, which is what you should be doing anyway, you can go there 24 hours a day and listen. I'm guessing, can you listen there, Cam?
Can you listen at the music hall?
Well, I know you can listen at the music hall, but how about your website?
Oh, yeah, you can listen to music. I have all of my original music on there along with some covers.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That's really great. I apologize, but when you sent me that information, I haven't gotten a chance to get
it. Don't worry about
it. But I have the luxury and the experience of hearing you perform live several times, and if your recording sound as good as you do live, then people are in for a real treat.
Oh, thank you so much.
Yeah, and thanks for being on the show.
Absolutely. This has been a blast.
Cool. Good. You've been playing your guitar for quite a few years and singing. And you started doing covers, I'm assuming, right?
Yep.
And your first, I'm trying to remember this, your first public performance was when you were 18.
That's right, yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to be that guy. And how many years then has it been since you've started performing?
Publicly or three?
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. It's going very, very well, I have to tell you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Not that you need my, like, my permission or, like, my opinion, but I really enjoy it.
Thank you.
I really enjoy listening to you, and the first time I saw you perform live was really cool, and that was at the Music Hall.
Mm-hmm.
When did you first find the Music Hall?
I found the Music Hall after I started performing at Old City.
Okay.
And Mark Wall would occasionally come and perform at Old City, mm-hmm. and he just started inviting people over to the Music Hall saying, hey, we have open mic, we're doing this, we're doing that. That same year, he invited me to do the showcase for Jacob Johnson.
Oh, yeah.
For the closing for that year. I think it was 2013. And it was just fantastic.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm really sad I missed that show. He's a pretty phenomenal guitar
player.
Well,
he's going to be back at the Music Hall December 5th.
Oh, that's right. So yeah. That'll be real cool.
Yeah, you definitely got to check that out.
And you are going to be at the Music Hall. Not just doing open mic stuff, but you're going to be doing the hook.
I am.
Which is really cool. That's a that is a local, well, it's a showcase of local bigger talent.
Songwriters.
Yeah, songwriters specifically.
Yep.
Local songwriters that are being very successful. And so I think that's really cool. They always have three performers.
Yep.
And they'll do like a round robin kind of thing where you'll swap songs and then you'll each get your own like 15 or 20 minute set in the second half, right? Second half. So where else then are you performing out?
I am performing in several places in Oswego. Mm-hmm. I performed in Mexico, Fairhaven, and I'm going to be in Rochester.
Cool.
Next month.
Cool. So are you actively promoting yourself and finding ways to find places, or are people contacting you? Or
Yeah, it's a little bit of both. Mm-hmm. I get a lot of recommendations from John McConnell.
Yep.
And he'll go talk to the owners of different establishments and say, hey, I know this guy, Cam Caruso. I'll go in and say, hey, I know John McConnell, and he recommended me for this place. And so I'll be like, yeah, I've heard of you, whatever. And then I'll give him a business card that has my website on it. They'll go on there, decide whether they like me or not, and hopefully I get on.
Cool. Cool. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So you're doing it, which is really cool.
Yeah.
When you're not playing your guitar, when you're not performing out, what kind of stuff are you doing?
I'm like a big film buff, and I actually like to go see a lot of stand-up comedy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I go to a lot of shows with my dad.
Cool.
That's like our bonding. Like a lot of like father sons have sports and stuff like that. Ours is stand-up.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Does your dad play the guitar?
No, he doesn't. Neither does my mom.
Okay.
Actually, a lot of my influence growing up was from my cousins.
Okay.
From different sides of the family.
Mm-hmm.
And they do like different genres and stuff.
Nice.
I have a cousin down in Georgia who does like blues stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I have one in South Carolina who does a lot of folk music.
Nice.
And then I actually have a classically trained guitarist in Las Vegas.
All right.
Yeah. So
that's really cool.
A lot of influence around the family.
That's neat. So you get to connect with them every once in a while? And
yeah, once in a while. Mm-hmm. More with the first two, the two from Georgia and South Carolina, but not as much with the guy in Vegas.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. Real neat.
Yeah.
I'm also wondering, since we're talking about influences, this is probably not a, I don't know. I don't know. I'm going to ask anyway.
Go for it.
Yeah. So how about influences from, like, I don't want to limit you to like top 40 names, but like,
oh, no, that's
you
fine.
Know, like bigger know names, you right?
Yeah. One of my biggest influences right now and for the past 2 or 3 years has been Ed Sheeran.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And just his songwriting, his storytelling, his guitar playing, his performances live are incredible.
Yeah.
Stuff what he does with just a guitar loop and microphone is insane.
Yeah.
Crazy.
That's really cool.
Mm-hmm.
Do you use a loop at all?
No, I've thought about it, but it takes like a lot of patience and timing, and everything has to be on point every time. My performances are inconsistent in a way that's bad, in a way that's okay, because it's different and I'm always experimenting with different things.
Yes.
With my performances.
Yep. Yep. Yeah. And your style fits that very well. I think it's very fluid and you're able to adapt and experiment with things. I think that's great.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's a really neat sound.
Yeah.
The first song that you sang at the beginning of the show was an original.
That was an original.
Okay.
Yes, it's called Blood in the Snow.
Mm-hmm.
It's on my EP entitled My Mental Paradise. Completely different sound from what I did here. That has a more folkier version with like violin and banjo and stuff.
Wow.
Like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that is available on iTunes along with the four other songs on there. And I actually have CDs for everyone here tonight to bring home. So
what?
If you like that song, then hopefully you'll like the others. And so yeah. You get a CD. You get a CD.
Yeah, that's what we need.
Yeah, we need Oprah.
We need to start taping stuff to the bottom of people's chairs. We had actually talked about that at one point. I'm out of...
Look under your seats...
You get to take home Cam Caruso. Hurry up. Get him out from under your seat. He's cramped.
Good luck.
So how many songs have you recorded?
I've recorded about 10.
All right.
I had an EP out in 2012, and it wasn't as professionally done as this past EP, so I just kind of threw it under the rug. Right. I still dabble with the songs on it, but I don't promote it nearly as much as this most recent EP.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. And if people are looking for that EP, they can find that on your website too?
They can find that on my website. On the front page of camcarusomusic.com, there's a picture of the album or the EP cover, and it looks like a little like cartoon drawing. And all you have to do is click on that. That'll bring you right to iTunes, and that's where you can buy all my songs.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Cool. Cool. So you, I know you're going to do a cover with Gina later in the show. You're going to do other originals though too?
Yep. I'm going to do another original.
Awesome.
Yep. This next one is not on the EP. This one I wrote about 3-4 months ago. This was after I found out my grandmother passed away.
Okay.
Yeah. She passed away a week after her 94th birthday.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And, she passed away right around 5 o'clock, May 9th, and it was in the middle of a gig.
Mm.
Yeah. And so, like, my parents got the phone call. They were freaking out. And so they, like, got to me, like, during my break, and they're like, all right, your grandmother passed away. And so, like, we don't know what you want to do for this gig or whatever. I said, all right, I'll cry later. And so I just played the rest of the show.
Wild.
Yeah.
Neat.
Yeah.
I mean, as neat as it can be. That's
it's a cool
story.
In the situation, yeah.
Right. Yeah. Right. When you had sent your notes in the email, you had mentioned something about that, and I was trying to figure out the best way that I could say, ooh, play that song. So I'm glad that you are.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's all planned out that way.
Awesome. Good, because I wanted to hear that song. So... grab your guitar, because I want to hear that song. Cam Caruso.
A silhouette in a broken heart. Towers rise and they fall apart in time. When they're past the prime, curtains close on your humble stage. Pass a torch to put out the flame for now, and take a bow. The applause for you from all your family and friends on cue. Empty chair, television on. Can conclusions could have been overdrawn, who knows? But it was time to go. Reaching out for the brighter light, seeing more than the black and white we made. They seem to fade. Did you feel lifted off your feet and gravity was only a bad dream? Did the pictures of your great-grandson comfort you when your final breath was done? What about now? Some of us didn't get to say goodbye. But it's over now. Don't worry about us, we'll be just fine. So be careful now. We'll see you when it's our time to fly. So watch your head when you pass the clouds, after ascending from this broken, crowded town. And don't look down, and you'll be missed by a thousand souls, with every bond you made, you sold their hearts. Right from the start, you and your love reunite after all 7 years when he took flight. Did your brother and sister meet you there with your mom and dad and the man upstairs? What about now? Some of us didn't get to say goodbye. But it's over now. Don't worry about us, we'll be just fine. Careful now, we'll see you when it's our time to fly. Careful now. we'll see when it's our time to fly. Be careful now.
Thank you.
Yeah, unfortunately, that song is not on Cam's latest EP. However, it's now in the archives of On the Porch Radio Hour. So folks can just play this episode over and over and over again until he gets his EP, and then you'll move on to another episode and just play that one over and over and over again. How's that for selfless? Sorry, I thought I'd try to get away with that. So Cam, how long after the passing of your grandma did you write that song?
I wrote it about a week after.
Okay.
Yep.
So you'd had about a week to sit with it, and then did you decide, I want to write a song, or did it just come to you?
Well, no, what had happened was I actually played it really a lot lower than I just played it, just performed it. I was just sitting with a friend of mine, and we were just chatting. I had my guitar in my hand, and we were going to go over stuff for open mic. And I was just sitting there just with that kind of groove. Mm-hmm. And I just sat there. We were chatting for about 3 hours. And I was just playing this over and over again.
Yeah.
She probably hates the song now because of it. And then a couple days later, I started making lyrics up for it. And like first couple lines just came to me.
A silhouette in a broken heart. Towers rise and they fall apart in time.
And then as it went on, it kind of more and more sounded like the experience of her passing.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks for explaining that and taking us through that. That was fun.
Absolutely.
Awesome, man. Thanks so much for being on the porch.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's hear some more from Cam. And Gina, I think you're going to hang out with Cam for a minute and sing something?
Yes.
We are going to be singing Poison and Wine by the Civil Wars.
You only know what I want you to.
I know everything you don't want me to.
Your mouth is poison, your mouth is wine.
You think your dreams are the same as mine.
Ooh, I don't love you, but I always will. Ooh, I don't love you, but I always will. I don't love you, but I always will. I always will.
You hold me when I turn my back.
The less I give, the more I get back.
Oh, your hands can heal, your hands can bruise.
I don't have a choice, but I still choose you. Oh, I don't love you, and I always will. Oh, I don't love you, and I always will. But I always will. I know I love you. But I always will. I know I love you. But I always will. I know I love you. But I always will. I always will. I always will.
Thank you.
Cam, thanks so much for being on the show again. It's really awesome to have you here. Yeah. This is one of those public confessions that I don't make often, but it's because of Cam Caruso that I started listening to songs by Sam Smith. How about we bring up Gina again, or actually keep her here? Just for now. Just stay up on the stage for right now. We'll keep you here. We'll have that conversation another time. Gina, sing us a song.
Frosty air, the trees so bare and gray, the autumn sky. The leaves are brown and all around, the green things fade and die. The stream is clear and flowing near, but fails to cheer the scene. While on the lee a young pine tree flaunts proud the only green, a sparrow nigh goes darting by with a chirp and flash of wing. And though it might make things more bright, we miss the birds that sing. This is the fall, brown leaves and all that nature brings us then. So make the best of nature's quest till springtime comes again.
June 13th, 1941. Patrick Winfoot came back to Tonkahogan. He had to come back because he had left. He had left just 5 years before that, in the middle of the Great Depression. He'd been raised on a farm, and his parents had been doing okay. But they weren't doing so okay anymore. And in the middle of the Great Depression, when you're not doing okay, you have to send your kids. And so he took off. Took off in the back of a covered wagon with a group of gypsies that came through Tonkahogan trying to sell their wares and play music for a couple of bucks. But in Tonkahogan, nobody had a couple of bucks. Everybody just needed to survive. So he grabbed his two extra shirts, his two extra pairs of pants, what he called his traveling hat, and his coat. And he piled into the back of this covered wagon. He knew how to play a couple of instruments because his grandfather had some that just hung on the wall. So every once in a while he would go over to his grandpa's house and pick them up and play. So he hung out with the gypsies and he traveled. And after the first year, they showed up in a town. And he performed music, and they threw money at his feet. When he got back to the covered wagon to leave that night, he handed half of the money to the leader of the group, who was at that point getting ready to drive the wagon out of town, and he said, "I'm staying." They thought maybe he'd fallen in love or decided he needed to find his way back home. But neither of those were the case. You see, Patrick had this really interesting experience that night. The moon was out, and it was bright and big and really low on the horizon. There was a thin layer of trees. And as he played his music, it almost seemed like where he was standing was rising and falling as he played his music. And the moon stayed in the same spot. But he was the one that was moving. And so from the different vantage points from where he was moving back and forth from, the moon would rise above the trees and sink below the trees and rise above the trees and sink below the trees. And he was confused. At one point he looked down because one of the people walking by had set a drink. They had set a bottle of whiskey at the bottom of his feet. And he was going to bend over and pick it up, and just for a split second, just for that one moment in time, everything stopped. And he could see a shadow on the ground. And the part of the shadow that he focused on was that he could see the shadow from his feet, beneath his feet. He thought it must have been a trick of the light. But it stayed with him. The idea that maybe his feet were off the ground, like he and gravity had parted ways, and it got his attention. And as he moved along the street that night with that bottle of whiskey and the borrowed banjo in his hand, he did a lot of thinking. And we got into that space where he was really thinking. He would end up in places that he wasn't intending on going because he needed to stop and think, but he just kept moving. Even though he'd stopped moving, he kept moving. This place must have been special. So he decided he needed to stay. They let him keep the banjo, and so he just traveled. He wanted to say that he was traveling by foot, but his feet weren't really what was taking him where he was going. And for the next 4 years, this is how he moved from place to place. And eventually he found himself back home. And everybody at home wondered where he'd gone and what he'd been doing. In a small town where you don't fit in, everyone knows who you are. And as the story goes, when Patrick showed up back in town, there was an air about him. A real, tangible air. It was described as where water and smoke, tangible and untangible, all come together and meet. And they wanted to touch it because it was solid. And as people reached out to shake his hand, they were paying more attention to what was between them than what was actually his hand. And as their hand moved through that, not water, not smoke, not air, whatever it was, they could watch it swirl. They could watch it move around them as their hand just moved the air enough to move whatever it was that they were seeing. In spirals and swirls, rising and dropping. And the crows that seemed to have followed him in town, or were awoken by his arrival back to town. But everywhere he went, he just glided. People were used to watching him walk. Before he left town, he was a tall, skinny kid. One of those people that you would say is all knees and elbows everything's just jointed and moves, almost like a marionette. A marionette that's directed and guided by somebody that hasn't quite figured out the fine tuning of using the strings and sticks. They weren't sure what was attached to Patrick, but it wasn't gravity. It wasn't air. So they decided to follow him. A group of folks from Tonkahogan needed to know. And people had been talking. Those conversations that happen at the barber shop, they all surrounded Patrick and how every night he went for his evening walk with his hat pulled low and his collar up around his neck. But his knees and elbows had left him, and he just glided from one place to another. And there were people that swore that his feet never touched the ground. And nobody dared ask him. He'll think I'm crazy. But they needed to know, so they watched. And over the course of a week, it seemed like more and more people, like pilgrims, just following that one star to wherever it was they needed to go. And that one star seemed to be a young man who liked to follow the shadows. It's hard to follow stars when you can't see them, but it's easy when you can feel them. And they were just dragged through this mist, this tangible, untangible smoke, and the crows. Nobody dared follow him into that patch of woods on the hill. That thin layer of trees. Like the thin layer of trees that he talked about in that town where he was playing his banjo and singing and watching the moon move in and out. And he'd walk there every night. And as soon as he crossed the shadow of the tree line, he disappeared. And sometimes moments, just tiny moments later, sometimes an hour, but always, before he came back out of the woods, the crows would fly in a flock. Crows don't ever fly in flocks. But there they were, silent, beautiful, without gravity. That one old man that hung out at the barber shop, that tried to explain what was happening to everybody, but nobody wanted to listen. He followed him. He followed Patrick into the woods. And the next morning, when he sat back down in that chair, and the whole barbershop leaned in, and all he could say was, "Come with me. I can't tell you." And he picked up the newspaper and hid behind it for the rest of the day. So that night, a couple more folks from the barbershop followed him down. That small pilgrimage that had gotten bigger and bigger. They would hit that invisible wall, but this small group broke away. And they kept what you might call a safe distance. But they took the same path, all leaning slightly to the left with their necks and heads cocked so they could really pay attention. Patrick glided into the woods, into those shadows, and they held their breath. And they all squatted down, peering out from behind one of the large pines on the edge of the woods. And they described it as he was just watching the moon, just standing there, watching, breathless. And we held our breath with him. But he took a big breath in, almost like he was making a sigh. And as he breathed out, those big elbows just pointed out. Then his hands reached into his pockets, as if he was just hanging out, ready for a stroll. But when those hands came back out of his pockets, the crows. And he just raised his hands in the air, and they flew. So many they blacked out the moon, and his hands went back into his pockets. And when they saw the brim of his hat tilt down, this is my home. This is my only home. This is the only sacred crown that I have ever known. And should I stray in the dark night alone, rock me, goddess, in the gentle arms of Eden. Rock me, goddess, in the gentle arms of Eden. Well, you've done it. Once again, you've made it through another episode of On the Porch Radio Hour. This, I think, is a turning point in the history of On the Porch Radio Hour. It was fun. I want to thank all of our slow audience members for being here tonight. And there was a long pause. I can edit that pause out. It'll be instant. Yeah, waiting for the fun. It was an awesome night. And I want to thank Adam Schmidtmann and Ben Borenstein and Cam Caruso for being on our show. And I want to thank everybody else that was here in the audience at the Wooden Apple Farmstead. You can listen to tonight's episode as many times as you want, along with all of the other episodes that we've recorded at www.ontheporch.weebly.com. Just go there and click on the Watch and Listen tab, and boom, they all pop up. I want to thank everybody for listening on Concert Window. Thanks for being here. The live show was fun. So was the recorded one. So I guess we'll see you around. Not next week. Next week, you're going to have to go without. Or, better yet, listen twice at ontheporch.weebly.com. Winky face for those of you that can't see me. But until the next time, peace to your journey.
On the Porch is a production of the Wooden Apple Farmstead, with host and writer Matthew Wood. Our musical director is Gina Holsapple. Our stage manager is Ray Monet. Our sound technician is Maxwell Wood. This week's guests include local musician Cam Caruso, and from CNY Arts Center's production of Oliver, director Adam Schmidtmann and music director Ben Borenstein. Find information about past shows, being on the porch, and much more online at ontheporch.weebly.com.